I am Bill Courtwright with Living Right with Bill Courtwright, and this is the Stress Mastery Podcast, where we take you from the science to the spirituality of stress mastery.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Stress Mastery Podcast. I am your host, Bill Courtwright, and I am here with the Friday version of the Super Millennial, Big David Barreto. How you doing, Big Dave?
I'm doing great.
This is a different Big Dave. Fat Dave, now it's Big Dave. There's two different Daves.
Yeah, very big.
This is a good Big Dave.
Yeah, now so, when you go to the gym and they say, hey, big guy, it feels different.
You don't feel offended anymore.
No.
Yeah, they say, hey, big guy, you don't suck your gut in anymore. I know that feeling. This week, our topic has been detachment. Kicked it off on Setup Sunday with talking about the two states of detachment. On Monday with the Super Millennial, David talked on developing the skill of detachment. On Health Huddles, we did part two of the process of creating successful weight loss. On Wednesday's Meeting of the Minds, we talked on the want of control. And on Connection Thursday, we talked on decisions equal consequences. Today, we'll continue our book study, Never Finished, by David Goggins, and we will close the week with our very own Coach Peggy discussing detachment. So, Big Dave, we are starting another chapter today, and this is chapter 5, and it's going to be done in two parts, just like the other one, because I don't want to skip any of the book, and it's a little bit long. So, part 1 of chapter 5, The Disciple of Discipline. Screw up the first word. Start off with the start over again. My vision narrowed as we pulled into the driveway at the crew cabin in Breckenridge, Colorado. It was just after 4 in the morning in the dark as hell. I could barely see as I stepped carefully down the short staircase leading to the front door. Kish watched me, concerned as I entered the house under my own power. I was hurting, but holding it together, and she knew I wouldn't show any weakness in front of my team. In fact, she assumed I'd keep walking all the way through our bedroom on the ground floor and into the bathroom where she could help me get undressed and cleaned up. But the thin thread I had been gripping tight to remain upright and presentable was fraying fast, and as soon as the guys were out of sight, it snapped. My knees buckled. I fell to the bedroom floor. Kish was right behind me. She closed the door and locked it, ripped the cover off the bed, spread it on the floor beside me, then did her best to reposition me into the bedspread to give me some semblance of comfort. She had no clue that her attentiveness made me anything but comfortable. Kish is such a neat freak. She is borderline OCD. Dust, dirt, and potential for germs gets her radar pinging on high alert. She's the first to comment when there is something foul in the air, and here I was smelling like an old dog who rolled in roadkill. My legs and feet were covered in mud and blood, my fingernails rimmed with dirt. A paste of filth and sweat coated my skin from toe to scalp. My breath was rapid, rancid, and shallow, and the mild tremors that had been only visible to Kish in the car because she was paying close attention had become bone-rattling shivers. Then my bowels groaned, and I knew it was about to get a whole lot worse. This was nothing new for me. Ever since my first ultra, the San Diego one day, the aftermath of every 100-mile race I completed included a tidal wave of pain and suffering, along with the humiliating loss of control of my most basic bodily functions. Kish knew that, but she had never experienced it firsthand, and I was nervous she wouldn't be able to handle it. The two of us are very different people. Kish is not an outdoorsy MF-er. If it weren't for me, she never would have heard of Leadville. Her idea of fun is spending a day on a pickleball court or a golf course or chilling at a 5-star resort. She's prissy as F. I'm a holdover beast from a different age. But when it comes to hard work and discipline, that's where we marry up. She keeps up in the gym and on the roads and trails and is a hard charger when it comes to business and understands my dedication to the grind in a way that no other woman, no other person in my life ever has. Yet aside from that one night in Nashville ER, she'd only ever seen me capable of enduring and withstanding almost anything, everything with little to no help and often with on very little sleep. I'd really shown her vulnerability, so how would she feel about me once she saw I wasn't even capable of wiping my own ass? Ashamed and embarrassed, I told her what was about to go down, and she looked horrified. Wait, David, not on a duvet. The what? I asked, delirious. The duvet? I must have looked confused as hell because I had never heard the word duvet in my entire effed up life. You know, the comforter that goes inside the duvet. Kish looked frazzled as she shook the snow-white linen beneath me, which is her abject horror, was getting soaked through with my foul post-race marinade. You're lying on it right now. You mean the blanket, I asked? She dashed out of the room without answering and returned with a black trash bag that she spread between me and the precious duvet like an open diaper. This is awesome, man. Only then did she tug my running shorts down to my thighs. My bowels unclenched and an ungodly stench rose up around us. As predicted, she had to wipe my behind because I couldn't move, and then she helped me up onto my knees so I could piss into some high-end decorative glass fruit bowl she found upstairs in the kitchen while she clenched her teeth and stressed about what this might do to her Airbnb rating. After all that, she peeled the shoes and socks off my feet, cleaned me up the best she could, and cocooned me in that I have to say it. In that fucking duvet. My eyes rolled up behind my saggy eyelids. I wasn't sleeping. I was attempting to savor the uncontrollable shivers and the filth of my own sick stench and many flavors of pain. The crushing agony in my hip flexors were searing. The only other time I'd ever felt anything like that was during the Wednesday night of my second hell week when I was rousted from a 5-minute power nap on the beach. Everyone else on my boat crew was getting a full hour, but not me. Psycho Pete, the instructor I hated the most, wanted a private audience. I remember trying to stand up with that maniac in my face. It felt like my hips were trapped in a vice. The only thing that would have eased the throb was curling up in a fetal position. So that's what I did in Breckenridge. Tripping on how pain has the power to bring you back in time like nothing else. As I lay there shivering and sweating at the same time, I could have sworn I was back on Coronado Island getting wet and sandy. Kish was terrified. She watched me, timed my arithmetic breaths, and listened to my bones rattle as she mapped out emergency contingencies in her head. Was I in shock? Was I having some sort of altitude reaction? Breckenridge is 9,600 feet. She was concerned my condition could deteriorate fast, but I wasn't worried about any of that. I knew that this was my old friend breakdown, my final phase of ultra. When I first got into endurance events, I loved the breakdown phase because the suffering made me feel alive. It reminded me that I had gone all out. Yeah, that's why I bodybuild. This time, I didn't relish it in the same way, but I knew that breakdown was a byproduct of an all-out effort, that if I explored the crevices of my mind, I would find valuable lessons, which tend to spill out with any unraveling. Most people prefer to avoid breakdowns like this because the suffering can be so overwhelming, it just might mark you forever. I embrace the breakdown. I welcome the scarring. There's a hell of a lot of information in scar tissue. Scars are proof that the past is real. Physical scars never go away. And when you look at them, they can bring you right back to a specific place in time. But the scar tissue that builds up around an old injury is weak. Professional fighters who've been hit in the face thousands of times bleed faster than those who have never been punched. Once you've been cut deep, you are forever vulnerable to bleeding. The same is true for mental and emotional scars that we all carry with us, the scars we cannot see. They might be invisible, but they affect us much more severely than physical scars. Mental and emotional scars are our weak spots, and they can open up just as easily as physical scars unless we do the work to strengthen them. If you haven't dealt with your scars, they can alter your life's path. You will be prone to failure during difficult and physical and emotional situations, whether that's during an athletic event or at work or in your home life, and eventually you will land back in front of your mirror that never lies. Breakdown is its own kind of mirror. Whatever you are made of is laid out in front of you, clear and plain. Your history and mindset become a weathered old map, bridged with your scars. And if you read them, like an archaeologist on a dig, you might uncover the code you need to rise again and become better and stronger. Because there is no transformation without breakdown. And there are always another evolution, another skin to shed, a better or deeper version of ourselves waiting to be revealed. I did a quick inventory of my scars as I faded into the slippery headspace between waking and dreaming. Psycho Pete's voice trailed off. Another familiar yet faint voice that I couldn't quite place called out to me. David, wake up. My memory convulsed and bled into my reality, and I couldn't tell where I was or what it was. David, he said gruffly, louder this time. Time to get up, boy. It was the voice of my grandfather, Sergeant Jack Gardner. Unlike those who embrace affectionate nicknames like Pop-Pop, Papa, or Grandpa, he instructed me to call him Sergeant Jack, and that set the tone for how things were going to be going, how things were going to be between us. Oh, yes, he left more than a few scars etched on my brain, and he was shaking me awake just like old times. It was the summer of 1983 when we staggered up this long gravel driveway, arrived at the doorstep, underslept, underfed, and with all our possessions crammed into black trash bags. My mother knocked on the door. While we waited, I scanned the yard. My grandparents had a big property, a full acre of land, including a wide, perfectly manicured lawn with train tracks running along one side. There wasn't a blade of grass out of place and not a single weed in sight. That should have been my first warning. While my dad was convinced that my grandparents had been behind our escape from Buffalo, he didn't witness our arrival or my grandmother Morna's wordless greeting on the front porch. She opened a door, rolled her eyes, and waved us inside. Sergeant Jack stood behind her with the expression of a drill sergeant watching his new recruits get off the bus with their long hair and beards all wet behind the ears. He'd been a master sergeant in the Air Force and had retired years ago, but was dressed in one of his flight suits. I didn't recognize the look on his face because I was disoriented, young pup all covered in scar tissue. But when I went to boot camp for the first time, I saw it again. That day in Brazil, though, he looked like a hero to me. I smiled. He did not smile back. It felt good to be there anyway. I was happy to be anywhere but on Paradise Road, and they were relieved that we had all gotten away from my father, but that didn't mean room and board and babysitting would be for free. The first bill came due before dawn the next morning when I was awakened by a stiff shake of my shoulders. I opened my eyes, and there was Sergeant Jack still in uniform. Time to get up, boy, he said. There's work to do. I wiped my eyes and glanced at my brother, who shrugged. It was still dark outside, and we were exhausted from the trip, and as soon as Sergeant Jack left the room, we fell back to sleep. The next wake-up call came with a form of glasses of cold water thrown in our faces. 2 minutes later, we were in a garage where he kept his old metal desk from the military. On the corner of that desk was a yellow notepad. The top of the page was titled Task List, dated and marked 0530. I had no clue what those numbers meant until Sergeant Jack explained his house ran on military time. That was the moment I realized that there would be no adjustment period and no coddling whatsoever. My grandparents never expressed basic sympathy for what we had been through. Sergeant Jack simply stared hard, went over the list, and walked us through the garage as if we were his new employees and needed to know where to find the rakes, the hose, the hedge clippers, and his quiver of brooms and dustpans, and how to operate and clean his manual lawnmower. He didn't care how we divided up the work, just that we got up and got to it on time. Each day started like that, with that unwelcome wake-up call, an itemized and military time-stamp task list, and a few, if any, words from the old man. Sergeant Jack was half Black and half Native American, and though he was only 5'7", he had a larger presence about him. He'd work as a cook in the Air Force and still dressed in his military attire every day. It was usually a flight suit or one of his battle dress uniforms on weekdays. His crisp dress blues were reserved for church and all other formal occasions. Sergeant Jack took great pride in detailed stewardship. He cared about everything he owned. He had two separate two-car garages and four cars on the property. Cadillacs and Chevrolets from the mid-century, like his well-tended house and garden, those cars were pristine. Born in 1905, he came of age in southern Indiana during the height of Jim Crow, when it was dangerous as hell to be a black man in America, and a wrong word or look could spark a lynch mob. His parents were poor, and he wasn't babied as a kid. His formal education ended in the fourth grade when he had to get a job to help support the family. So when I landed in his house, he passed along what he had learned. What they taught him worked as far as he was concerned. He had a military pension. He owned his house free and clear. Same with every car in his garage. And he had money in the bank. Sergeant Jack was squared the F away, and he got there with self-reliance on detail and discipline. Each morning before he woke me up, we walked the perimeter of his property, surveying the lawn, several trees, and a long unpaved driveway blanketed in snow-white gravel. The house had two porches, one on either side, and he liked them swept and his rain gutters cleared of debris at all times because storms come down hard in this part of the country. Sergeant Jack couldn't stand seeing leaf litter, dust, or weeds. Everything had to be immaculate. The daily task list was always at least 10 tasks long. Sometimes it stretched to over 20. The first order of business in the morning was to sweep both porches, front and back. After that, I had to get out the rake, collect the bag, any stray leaves that had fallen overnight. In the spring and summer, that wasn't a huge job. But in the fall, when the leaves turned, it took hours. Hedges and grass grew like crazy during the humid Indiana summer, and that meant mowing the lawn manually in perfect grid and clipping all the hedges almost daily. Weeds are always a problem in the summer, and as soon as they began poking through the gravel on the driveway, I had to get on my hands and knees and dig into the dirt to pull those effers free. And the gravel dug into my skin, leaving scrapes and bruises. To me, it didn't feel a whole lot different from scraping gum off the skate rink floor at first. In those early weeks, I took Sergeant Jack's test as a sign that no matter where I lived or who I lived with, I was bound to suffer at the hands of a bully. My scarred young mind was deep in a woe-is-me rinse cycle. So was my brother's. He didn't last long as Sergeant Jack detail and retreated to Buffalo pretty quickly. Crazy to think that Buffalo seemed like a better option. I wasn't going anywhere, but that doesn't mean I enjoyed it. At first, I despised the man and attempted to rebel. He'd come shake me awake and I wouldn't move. Then he'd splash water in his face. I took that too. If I still didn't get up, he'd come at my bedside with a metal trash can lid and whack it with a wooden spoon next to my ear until I was up on my way to the garage to pick up my orders. I didn't yet realize that Sergeant Jack was no truness. He was my Mr. Miyagi. Not in the sense of that each chore came with a specific instructions or that those instructions would manifest in skills that would deliver karate tournament salvation. He never sat back and said, "I'm teaching you how to be responsible, young man." Yet I learned valuable life lessons. Many of us will meet people like Sergeant Jack in our lives, an elder or a teacher who refuses to tell us what we want to hear in the way we want to hear it. And when you're emotionally scarred like I was, any and every hard look or gruff reply, any order or mandate can feel like a personal attack, and oftentimes we tune them out to our own detriment. It took me a long time to understand that there wasn't anything personal about Sergeant Jack's approach or his list. It was transactional. So I'm going to stop there. It's halfway through this chapter, and I'm going to turn it over to Super Millennial. So this chapter is pretty cool because it gets even better as it goes. But yeah, Sergeant Jack was awesome. So what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts on this?
You know, it's interesting because as I was young, I always thought that like my Uncle Ed or my dad, they had very weird like chores and stuff for us to do, and it had to be done in a very specific way, and we all thought it was stupid. Like my dad was like, "If you go vacuum, leave the lines." I'm like, "Leave the lines? What does that even matter? We walk on in the next few hours." Like he was always like that for everything. If it was put away, put it away right. You go do something right. And I remember having a vacuum like six different times over, and I realized as I got older, like as I started to do certain things in a very specific manner, and as it falls into my routine, he wasn't telling me to clean, because obviously the fifth time I did it, the sixth time I did it, it was clean. It was to do things the right way, to teach me to, if you're going to do it, don't half-ass it. Do it the right way. And my Uncle Ed was the exact same way. We would clean, he'd come and check. Clean and come and check. And soon enough, like as we got older, he stopped checking because we would clean it the right way every time. And now, you know, living on my own and doing stuff like that, like I put things away very specifically. I have supplements and my bathroom is set up very specifically. And I realized that that is the thing that has kept me going. When motivation's not there, when the want to do it or want to work out or want to do anything is there, the discipline that's like hardwired in me now, it just, you do it. And the things that are done correctly to me is what's been like the edge to continue going. So I think that's something I learned, you know, as I got older. I think people who are listening who are younger that look at like the older generation, like, you guys are so dumb for doing it. I promise you, as you get older, you start looking back at some of these things and say, like, I would have started that just a little earlier. Wow. Like, so I think that was a big thing. That's why I always say now, listen to the older generations, listen to the younger generations, because at certain things, especially when it comes to discipline, I feel like the older generation definitely has it down differently, because things are a lot easier now.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, so a couple of things from this chapter, because it's going to, the chapter is going to evolve, obviously. First of all, the relationship that Goggins has with his wife.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That reminds me of me and Linda so much, it's ridiculous, mm-hmm. right? Because they're really different, yet they're kindred spirits. And it's amazing to watch that, right? Because he's honest. She's the opposite of him. This is why I always tell people, it's not about being with somebody like-minded, being with somebody like-energetic, right? So, but when it comes to certain parts, he says they connect perfectly. That's Linda and I. Linda does not live like I live, you know, and I don't live like she lives. But when we come together, we're better than we're apart. He really has a hell of a relationship there. And I thought, wow, man, you know, it's like, doesn't she sound like Linda a little bit?
Right? It was interesting because as I was like listening to this and I was thinking about like, you know, me and Vanessa are like, now it's weird how identical we are, right? But we're different in the way we approach things. So even though we eat the same, we train the same, we sleep the same, our interests are the same, all that stuff's, you know, similar. The way that she gets through situations and how I get through situations is so different. But when I find myself like, you know, in the prep where I was just laying down literally on the floor with Marley, like I'm done, I'm giving up. She treats me different. Like her strong suits were what I needed versus my weak points. And then when she's like, oh, I don't want to do it, my being a tough ass to her and stuff like that, like is what she needs. So we're the same, but we're different in the weak points that make strengths for each other.
It makes a relationship work. Yeah. That's what we call an expansion relationship. Both people can grow. So that was the first thing. Now the discipline, right? So I had a very similar thing. Obviously you guys all know that I ended up with my grandparents. My grandfather was very similar to Sergeant Jack. He was very disciplined, you know? Now the thing was, in today's world, parents are afraid to be tough with their kids because they want their kids to be like them. They want to be friends. You know? Well, you know, I don't care if you're friends. So grandpa was tough on me, but he would work shifts and grandma was easy on me. So I manipulated grandma, but I couldn't get away with anything with grandpa. But like chores, I didn't have any chores until I was with my grandparents, but I actually liked chores. I liked mowing the lawn. I turned it into a game. I liked this. I turned it into a game. I liked that. I turned it into a game. You know why? Because I got positive attention from it.
Yeah.
You know, so that I didn't get any positive attention until I got there. So that developed a discipline. And people always tell me how disciplined I am. And I learned that from him. Laying the clothes out, way I set me up. I got, everything's got its place. You know, he was stickler on that. And like, You're going to hear later as the chapter goes on and the book goes on, how much that David Goggins got from Sergeant Jack. A lot. He doesn't realize you're getting it when you're young. I did not have that type of experience. I didn't have that negative experience that he was having when he first got there, because my grandfather was tough, but he wasn't Sergeant Jack, you know? So, but he was tough getting me up at a certain time, making me, he made me accountable. Right. Mm-hmm. But I liked it because I got attention. I got positive attention, which I never got before. So I never mind. Oh yeah, I'm a lawn. Oh yeah, I'll do this. Oh, I'll do that. You know, I actually did more because I wanted to be liked so badly, you know? So I was not one that didn't want to do stuff, but it wasn't that tough. I didn't have that bad of experience like that, but I would manipulate grandma. Grandma, when he worked like the night shifts or stuff and he wasn't there, then I would slack off. I can remember slacking off. You know, I don't need to do this. Grandpa's not, he's working. He's not going to know anything like that. But you know what? He always knew. Damn it. I don't know how he did it. I know she didn't tell on me, but he just knew. And then you know what? He never got mad. Never raised his voice at me. He would just say, a little disappointed in you, Billy. Oh my God, just hit me. It felt better if you just hit me than say that to me. But that would always get me going because I always wanted to have that positive attention. So what's happening in this chapter is David, he had to go through with his father. They had to do a lot of chores. That wasn't discipline. That was abuse. You're going to see how this is going to be very different as this chapter moves on. Sergeant Jack's teaching him something. His father just was abusing him. Wasn't teaching him anything. It was like a master telling, you know, their worker, this is who you are. This is what you're going to do. You're nothing but you work for me. That's not what Sergeant Jack was doing. But I can understand how he felt that way. Because when you're afraid, literally the first day he's there, nothing. Hey, are you okay? Is everything all right? No. Let's get up. 5:30. Oh, 5:30. Let's go.
Yeah.
And so, but this chapter is going to evolve. But I like it a lot. I like this is going to be about discipline. And him doing the race and going through that, I understand it completely. Completely what he's saying. Now you understand too.
Yeah. Almost to where it sounds crazy, like almost like masochistic to enjoy that pain that's after. Yep. It's weird, and it's an interesting thing. But you know, it's things that like the discipline part gets you to that part. It's kind of cool how it kind of like went almost backwards, because the discipline is really what drove that. And I thought that was interesting because like what you said about his dad using this chores as like punishments and things like that. I never got punished for chores. He took away things I enjoyed, fun, things like that. But chores were something we did. Like, it wasn't a punishment. You just had to do it. And I remember doing it to the point where my dad used to work so many hours so we could slack off if we wanted to. But then he would get home, and then the moment he gets home, guys, what? Come on. And I realized that when he gave us all those things, it's because he didn't have time to do it. So when he stopped getting mad about it, that's when I started feeling bad. If he doesn't have the energy to let alone like do some of the chores, he didn't even have the energy to yell or like just be upset that he was just, I'm tired, I'm going to the room. And it's like, you know, so I started doing them as just, you're pitching in, you're contributing to something. And I didn't realize that was actually contributing to like, you know, older David at a younger age. Like that's what my dad was teaching, because my grandma's like that. Everybody, all my uncles are very similar. I realized that was something he was passing down because it served all of them very well, being disciplined, because they all succeeded in their jobs. I think the, you know, stupid lines in the floor was just, if you're going to do something right, no matter what it is.
Detail, man. If you're going to do it right. Yeah. Very good. So next week, what is our topic? We're talking, it's going to be fun. Self-control is the topic next week, boys and girls. That'll be fun. So tune in to Peggy's episode tomorrow, and Sunday I will kick off the week on self-control. That'll be perfect. That's it for today's show. Our mission here is to create a shift in the planet. You can join us on this mission by simply like, share, and subscribe. Those links are right below the show notes. As always, until next time, stay inspired.